Well, 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 as it seems, the seven seas remain to be the living embodiment of human curiosity, and the infinite mysteries of what lurks at the bottom of the deepest depths of the ocean bed was a little bit more than what we first anticipated, given the fact that in our previous video we hypothetically drained the oceans through ingenious means and were left to ponder over the dilemma of what our civilization would do with all that new room for activities. As many of you have astutely pointed out, there's a lot to this particular hypothetical notion, so much so that it seems we've got reason enough to revisit a planet Earth where all of the oceans have been drained. Hello internet, what's going on? And once again, welcome back to the most inquisitive channel on YouTube, Life's Biggest Questions. As per usual, I'll be your disembodied floating voice, Jack Finch, as today we curiously revisit the question in What If We Drain the Oceans? Part 2. Roll the clip. Wait, would that be What If We Drain the Oceans, the re-sequel? Or What If We Drain the Oceans, the second drainage? Yeah, I'm not entirely sure, but the fact of the matter remains, that clip in particular was from 1998's Deep Rising, and as many of you pointed out in our previous video, the gigantic and terrifying octopus would be the least of our worries if we'd accidentally, suddenly, drained our oceans, because, well, there'd probably be at least three great old ones lurking down there, as well as the High Priest of Valier himself, alongside several Megalodons, Jormungandr, and, oh, I don't know, a few underwater ancient cities, probably. In fact, as we tried our utmost to vividly portray in part one to this video, draining the oceans would be like pulling out your living room sofa and discovering all of the strange things that you'd lost over the years. And as you may imagine, all of those curious and interesting hypothetical artifacts are definitely worth a revisit, given the fact that there's an estimated $60 billion worth of treasure lingering at the bottom of the ocean bed. However, before we dive into this Life's Biggest Questions, we're going to be doing something a little bit different today. For the first time ever, we're going to be taking a look at your wittiest and most insightful comments from part one of this video, and we're going to do our best to elaborate on the best of these particular hypothetical notions. And who knows, maybe it'll just be a new thing that we do over here at Life's Biggest Questions. That'd be fun, won't it? In that case, we better get started, right? Perhaps our most insightful comment from part one of this video comes from good golly Miss Molly, who says, "Can you imagine all of the fighting for the new land? Since the ocean is international, no one currently owns or rules it. So if the oceans disappeared, then nations would go to war over who gets to own it all." And wow, whilst also being an incredibly astute observation, this is perhaps the biggest and most important issue that we have to address following the subsequent drainage of our oceans. So in that case, thank you, Molly. The fact of the matter remains, international law and socio-political boundaries have, for the most part, been drawn around the boundaries of our own oceans. Australia is over there in the Pacific doing its thing, chilling with New Zealand, and then the Americas are far, far away on the other side. An entire Pacific Ocean separates the two. And as any of you who have played Sid Meier's Civilization will know, it's very important for civilizations to have an adequate landmass between them. To begin with, anyway, because that's before Gandhi starts stockpiling nuclear weapons, and suddenly everyone starts sweating a little. The fact that our planet has been covered by such a vast amount of water has been a central proponent in the creation and subsequent growth of our civilization. But with that gone, it's pretty much a field day, and international etiquette would go hurtling out the window like the baby with the bathwater as governments across the planet scrambled for the huge swathe of newly unearthed resources previously submerged by our oceans, like the first kids at recess to hog the swing set. And no one liked that kid, unless you were that kid, in which case, good job, buddy. And in this metaphor, you're probably also America. Currently, our planet is governed by the rule of international waters, or transboundary waters, which apply to every boundary of water that transcend national bodies of water, most prominently the high seas, which do not belong to any state's jurisdiction. This unbound law is encapsulated under Mare Liberum, an ancient agreement which means free sea in Latin, but was officially signed and documented in 1958 under the Convention of the High Seas, which currently has 63 signatories, all of which agreed that the ocean was pretty much off limits to anyone trying to stake a permanent claim to it. That means you couldn't go around sticking a flag on a buoy and then say, "Hey, we own this bit now, you can't come here." And And obviously, as you may imagine, and as Molly so efficiently pointed out, that convention, signed, sealed, and delivered by 63 countries on the planet, would be instantly forgotten and ripped to shreds in this particular instance. Now, you may be thinking, okay, come on, what would all the rush be though? Would it really be that bad? Why would a completely reasonable society drop everything they're doing just so they could stick a flag in a portion of newly discovered wet sand? There's no guarantee that land is even going to be worth anything, right? Well, incredibly wrong. There is currently no landmass on Earth that isn't owned in some form or another by a government, and many of the borders of those landmasses are currently being poked and prodded by bigger countries with bigger sticks still to this day. In fact, all of our early history since the dawn of the Roman Empire, and perhaps thousands of years before that, has been about warring with each other about who gets to live where and where that line in the sand is drawn. It's only recently, as in the past half a century, that we've grown relatively comfortable with the lines on the map, albeit that's not to detract from the terrible reality of the mass displacement of people across the planet currently. But in this situation, that same mass of Earth that has been in contention for the past 10,000 years, well, it just tripled in size. That means, given our hypothetical situation, there is now 360 million square kilometers worth of brand new landmass to fight over. So, yeah, as Molly pointed out, things would get pretty bad for the next few generations. 360 million square kilometers used to be a lot of water, but now in this case, it's just a lot of war. But if you think that's bad, Jonathan M. Conway has an even more terrifying way of looking at things. He says, love the vid, but if we drain the oceans, the planet would turn into a version of Mustafar from Star Wars for two main reasons. One, the oceans stop both the underwater volcanoes exploding, and two, it stops the tectonic plates from shifting. The planet would pretty much burn and would be unlivable. Yeah. Jonathan, my man, you pretty much hit the nail on the head there, and it's one fact that we segued a little in part one of this video, given the fact that it would have made most things pretty impossible. If we take the Ring of Fire alone, the major area of volcanic and tectonic activity that occurs in the basin of the Pacific Ocean and covers an area of over 25,000 miles, now the Ring of Fire on its own is responsible for countless volcanic eruptions, many of which would be earth-shattering if it wasn't for the fact that our comforting blanket of ocean nullifies pretty much all of the devastation caused beneath. With that ocean gone, yeah, that's 25,000 miles worth of prime volcanic activity, and all of those people warring for that newly discovered landmass, yeah, they'd get covered in molten lava pretty quickly. Yeah, and that's how it always ends in these videos, doesn't it? Well, there we have it, our revisit to the question, what if we drain the ocean? We'd just like to give a huge thank you to both of our commenters in today's video, good golly Miss Molly and Jonathan M. Conway. Well, what did you guys think to our new format? Do you think it's interesting? Do you think it's worth sticking around for? Let us know your thoughts down in the comment section below, and we'll see what we can do. Unfortunately, that's all we've got time for in today's video. Just stick around all the way until the end. If you were a fan of this video, or just Life's Biggest Questions in particular, then please be a dear and hit that thumbs up button, as well as that subscribe bell, and I'll be seeing you in the next one. As per usual, I've been your disembodied floating voice, Jack Finch. You've been watching Life's Biggest Questions. Until next time, you take it easy.